Welcome to the Political Courage Podcast, the podcast dedicated to telling the stories of courageous people in politics. Please visit our website at douglas-perkins.com/political-courage. There you will find links to our podcast episodes, our YouTube page, social media accounts, and other bonus material dedicated to each of our episodes. Today is our latest in our series of episodes interviewing influential people in politics. We are discussing policy, courageous leadership, campaigns, party platforms, politics in general, and a little bit about the two most recent the presidential administrations. These interviews are all available on our website as both audio podcasts and videos from our YouTube channel. So with that, I would like to introduce my guest today, Rina Shah. Excuse me, I'm still getting over my cold. I apologize. Rina is a businesswoman, a political advisor, and geopolitical expert with nearly 40 campaigns under her belt. She has degrees from West Virginia University, George Washington University, and Cornell. She has been called, quote, a savvy political advisor who is a bit politically homeless with the shift in the GOP over the years, unquote. So I think there are a number of us in the nation that can that feel a little bit of that political homelessness right now. She is the CEO of Relax. Am I pronouncing that right, Rina? Relax Strategies, a political, public affairs, and strategic communications firm. She is also a senior advisor to Red Fort Strategies, Vote Run Lead, and the Renew Democracy Initiative. So with that, you know, I could go on and on. She's got a lot of experience, got a very impressive resume. I could go on, but we'll leave it at that and get down to our topics. And with that, welcome, Rina.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
So it's wonderful. I greatly appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule. It's very busy right now. Congress is in session and so much going on. We were a little bit delayed. We're recording this Thursday morning. We were a little bit delayed with Rina taking the time to listen to Nancy Pelosi's speech. And so it's kind of an interesting time, and I am greatly appreciative to Rina for taking the time out of her busy schedule. So, Rina, you are involved with numerous political groups. It is important for us to understand as we go in and discuss things and ask questions of you, it's very important for us to understand your goals and the purpose for the different groups that you are personally involved with. So we're going to go through each of those a little bit and ask you questions. So Relax Strategies, you are the founder and CEO, correct?
Correct. 10 years in business. This is my 10th year. I celebrated at the top of January, and it feels funny because there were many times I thought I'm going to have to shutter. I'm going to have to close down this business. It's maybe not a business for me anymore, but I managed to make it to the 10-year mark. And for me, that's real success. My folks are both immigrants to this country, and I lost my dad a few years ago. But the legacy of his was that you can come over here and do whatever you want to do as long as you dream it and work really hard. And so though it's been a tough 10 years for me in business, it's sure. been the pleasure of a lifetime to be able to say I'm a business owner and work for myself. In this new chapter in my life, it's gotten a little more difficult because I have children and a marriage to balance as well. But really finding a way to stay afloat in today's environment. I went from being a solid political operative, so really offering general political consulting services. A lot of how I made my money in the early years was speech writing for people who are running for Congress and people who are already in Congress. And that was a really incredible thing for me because I've always loved writing. I've always loved communicating ideas. And that was something that felt very natural after I left Capitol Hill. I was on Capitol Hill for a few years, working for two different Republican members of Congress. And then I jumped right into political consulting. So pivoting out of political consulting right around 2015, 2016 was natural to me because I felt like, how am I going to keep this business afloat if I can't really evolve and offer new services? So I've gone into a few different veins of work, I'd say, that have springboarded from my political expertise. I've worked with startups. I've worked with multinational corporations. I've mm-hmm. provided legislative strategy and continue to corporations that are both here domestic and abroad. So it's such a joy to be able to do this work. I enjoy it very much.
Good for you. So you are also the advisor of Renew Democracy Initiative. And this is the one that most fascinates me, is your most of my questions, most of the things that come from me are going to be around yourself personally as a political operative, as a strategist, as an advisor, and around the RDI.
Sure.
Because I'm just so fascinated by their approach, their values, their mission and their goals. And so it seems to fall so in line with what I am doing, what I hope to be accomplishing with this podcast and my writing and so forth. So if you will, I just want to read the mission a little bit of the sure. Renew Democracy Initiative, and then we'll have you explain a little bit about it and what you do for them. Okay. Is that all right?
Indeed.
So, the Renew Democracy Initiative, Renewing Democracy for All, RDI is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization dedicated to empowering the public to uphold constitutional principles in their civic behavior. Mission: we aim to create a movement united by the common language of constitutional values. Threats to our democracy, such as misinformation, foreign intervention, and demagoguery, will not disappear. But we can create resilience to these dangers by working together to promote democratic principles and civic behavior in the public sphere. Now, there's a lot there, but we'll go into those things. There's two goals listed also for the initiative. Create the intellectual foundation that would make significant political reform possible. Now, that's so huge. Significant political reform. Just so huge. Yeah, huge lofty goal. And number two, foster a national movement that prioritizes American leadership, free discourse, and constitutional principles. So, that just tells our listeners, in a nutshell, what the Renew Democracy Initiative is. And now, if you will just talk a little bit about it for a couple of minutes and tell us your role, if you would, please.
Sure. I'm delighted to be a relatively new member of the Board of Advisors for RDI. I really just joined only earlier this year, and it was after watching the organization for about a year. If anybody knows chess, you know world chess champion, the former Garry Kasparov, is also a very famous political activist and Russian dissident, somebody who I've greatly respected. My family, ancestrally, we are from India, and there's a lot of love for the game of chess out of India. So I grew up really admiring the game, and as a former political strategist, I can say that the strategy is everything in life. So Garry is somebody I have really respected. He set out and created RDI only a few years ago. So we are a nascent organization. As an advisor to RDI, I'm really tasked with one thing, is really promoting what we're doing and promoting the organization's mission, not just here domestically. We seek to be the preeminent pro-democracy org in the world. And we're going to do that because we're bringing together dissidents from so many parts of the world. We've already had events. One event this past spring that really solidified to me that I got to be part of this group was one with a few dissidents where you're hearing in their words exactly how their lives have been impacted by what their government is doing. And by simply speaking out, exercising what is our, here in the U.S., First Amendment right, put their lives on the line, put them at great risk, put their families at risk, and put everything in jeopardy for them. So the stories of dissidents have long sort of fueled me and my passion for political reform in this country. Now, I've always been right of center. It's secret that I made my career in the Republican Party. I'm center right to this day for the most part, but I'm also what I think in an ideal democracy, the voter votes along, not along party lines, votes on the issues. So I really consider myself in this moment more of a centrist, a radical centrist, if you will. I have a few friends who use that phrase and we love it. But a radical centrist who is independently minded. I've always been independently minded, but coming together under the banner of RDI and talking about the principles of liberal democracy and why they are important to not just teach, but to put in action for the young people here in our country today and around the world to show why we should value these. I think this is the moment that's more important than ever before. So yes, to me, this is the passion. Really, I have a story arc that fits my family's origin story fits right in with RDI. And frankly, there are many political reform orgs to choose from, many doing so much great work. But if any of our listeners, and of course you, Doug, we want people to get involved. We want our everyday citizens to be at the table together. We all need to come together to do this work, to promote these principles that are frankly enshrined in our Constitution. And you can just see in everyday life, but sometimes in unique portions of history for our country, they've been put at great risk. And in those moments, in that fear is when we suddenly see our fellow citizens sort of wake up and have to live in that fear. That should not be how this country operates. I said on Twitter the other day, Americans deserve a working democracy. So I'm committed to that. I'm committed to doing the work that all of us individuals have to do to make sure that America remains a light for the world, sets an example and does better, continues to evolve. I think that's what our founders wanted. So under RDI's banner, we are trying many efforts. We're going to get more creative as time goes on. Again, we're a very young organization, but the possibilities are endless. The programming we've put out so far, just this past week, we had Ben Rhodes, former Obama National Security Advisor, admit he was wrong about something to another dissident. So we get those conversations going. We're the only place those conversations are happening. And I really encourage folks, listeners, if you want to get involved with RDI, we need everybody under the banner, because we can only do this once we get the masses mobilized with these ideas of how the country can grow and what is our individual sort of responsibility to promote these values that have brought the country to where it is.
So I encourage all of you out there, go to the initiative's website, rdi.org. There you'll find a list of the values that they promote, their approach to educating the public on these. And also, interestingly, go to the team. I believe it's under team as I was visiting it earlier. But
yeah, we've got a good group.
the team is quite amazing. You know, you hear Rina talk about the influence that the initiative carries. And so if you go and you look at the team, it's quite impressive, the people that they have on there as their board of directors and as advisors and so forth. You will see quite an impressive list of people involved in politics, both as office holders, as people that are pushing the movement and so forth, and they carry impressive resumes.
Thank you, former senators. I'd like to jump on that for a second, if you wouldn't mind, and mention. I quickly touch on this about my story arc, but I think why I really wanted to go to RDI more than anywhere else, and I do give my time to a number of political reform efforts as well. There are such great ones out there. Renew America Movement is another one of really, really fantastic people who are talking about the very things that I said RDI is committed to. So there are a lot of people in the ecosystem. We're all very collaborative. But for RDI, for me, being the daughter of immigrants, one of them from Uganda, my father was born and raised in Uganda. We had three generations there, and we lost everything under a dictator, Idi Amin. So for me, it was very natural to sort of see what can happen when government gets too big, too oppressive, and when a dictator threatens life for people. It was a genocide in Uganda. We have family members who made it out just barely. My own grandfather was sent to what was akin to a concentration camp and made it out alive, thank goodness, simply because of an uncle's relation with the dictator. These are the stories that I am proud that my family survived. We made it. And most of my family went as refugees to the UK. My father was already in the US, but we lost everything, three generations of wealth, simply because a dictator didn't like the color of our skin. So in 2016, when I was the first RNC delegate to speak out against Donald Trump as a candidate, it was just something natural I did. It was not some courageous act in my mind. It wasn't something I set out to do. It was just something that felt natural to express my concern. I thought it was my First Amendment right. This is a free country. I can live without fear of persecution for expressing my opinions in the public sphere. What I realized after is that there will be a mob that comes after you if they don't like what you say. And they tried to cancel me. And thankfully, they were unsuccessful. They did cancel me, and I was reinstated. But it took a great big fight and a lot of money and a lot of time and a lot of heartache when I went through all that. So being aligned with RDI is a very natural thing for me. These dissidents have been through far more than what I described for myself. But the fact is that this stuff happens in America, and it happens even now today. People are threatened for speaking their mind. And we have a whole bunch of stuff the RDI is gonna be vocal and out front about in the coming months. But one last thing I wanna share with you, and this sure. this is very good news and very newsy, is that we are next month debuting with CNN. RDI is going to be doing a special project with CNN. It's gonna be called The Voices of Freedom. And we are officially launching around the first of the month, in November, the first week. And so we've confirmed about nearly 50 dissidents from about 30 countries. And it's going to include just an incredible array of folks, big names, names that you've never heard of, but their stories are going to be gripping. So I really thank you for letting me shine the light on an organization that I'm just so passionate about and giving a lot of my time to right now, because I believe this is just the most important work of my time.
Fantastic. Yeah, we'll help promote that if we can. You bet. So you mentioned, let's address something that you talked about. So you talked about briefly there that you were the first RNC delegate to go and publicly speak out against Donald Trump in 2016. So let me ask you a question. Do you consider yourself now, okay, that's 5 years ago. Do you consider yourself now a Republican or a conservative without a party?
You know, after that five,
talked about the homelessness, right?
Yeah. And that's a phrase I thought I'd never have to ever utter, is being politically homeless, feeling that way, because I made my career in politics squarely since 2008. And so really from, and I was always a very political person before, not a hyper partisan person. There's a big difference. I was always involved. Yeah. I always felt I had a place. And I know in this country, we don't do the best job in the United States, across the states, of teaching history well, of civics. I just think we can do better. And that's not to put the blame on one thing. I think it's a collective blame almost. As a society, you don't know what you've got until it's gone. And so being a politically homeless person, stepping off a five-year roller coaster, I can say I really feel as if I'm an independent. I do choose to sometimes click Republican when I feel it's right. But I also am somebody that punished Republicans at the ballot box in 2018, at the midterms. For anybody who put an R next to their name, I just felt so very strongly that it needed to be done. But that's not to say I won't vote for Republicans again. It's not to say I won't vote for Democrats again. It's to say that I'm an independent now. Yeah.
It's how you personally feel, right?
It's how I feel.
It's not. It doesn't have to do with necessarily with what you're doing at the ballot box. It has to do with how you feel personally as you're addressing policy. And as you're looking at policy and how you feel regarding those bills and legislation and whatever else, you know, I feel similar. So let me ask you this. So on the Political Courage podcast, we promote courageous leadership, and we advocate bipartisan leadership and unity and everything else. So that being said, President Biden talked quite a bit in his inaugural address about unity and equity and so forth. We haven't necessarily seen it. I don't believe with the parties the way they are right now, further apart than they ever have been, is unity possible? And can Biden accomplish what he promised regarding unity?
Yeah, to me, unity is never not possible. Okay, that's just that's the mindset I've always had. I don't think I could have ever worked in politics for as long as I have, and government, if I weren't a forever optimist. And so I really believe that what we saw from candidate Biden, we definitely saw somebody who campaigned very, very firmly and strongly on that idea that he could bring the nation together. I think now, sitting at the point we were sitting at, you know, this is a year out from election 2020, there is some buyer's remorse for folks, you know, like myself, who crossed over. Of course, I was not going to vote for Trump. That was never going to happen for me. But giving Biden my vote, I felt that he was going to come in and do things differently, that the reset button wasn't just going to be a hit of the button and going back to, say, you know, Obama era stuff. What we've seen is a little bit of Obama 2.0, and not a little bit, a lot bit. You see a lot of the same staffers. You see things haven't really changed. To some degree, I think it's even fair to say that Biden and his team expected to go in there and their mere presence would bring things back to normal. So that unity we heard about on the trail, to some extent, felt like a talking point, because did he appoint any members of another party to his cabinet, to his administration? Has he made those high profile picks of prominent Republicans who were out there during the convention and prior for him? No, there has not been that courting that has felt genuine. And I can say that as somebody who's been intimately familiar with that process. I actually started Republican Women for Biden. So to be helpful during the campaign to the Biden administration, or to the Biden campaign, and hopefully to the future administration. But it seems that there's not much interest in that. Now I'm not quick to place blame. I want to give them some more time and assess what's going on here. But over these past many months, I don't use buyer's remorse lightly. That's a loaded phrase. And that's to say, there are some very non-moderate positions this president has taken in regards to fiscal policies. And now moderates, again, like myself, people were center right, felt very moderate, are pretty disappointed with a lot of what the president has put forward in the tax plan. It's almost to some extent punitive to those who want to achieve the American dream, those who are in that middle class set who can go from being middle class today to being very wealthy tomorrow. Now, the super rich, are they going to feel the pain of the Biden tax plan? I don't think so. It has not been read prominent economists and experts who've said this is a plan that, and you don't have to be an expert to see it. This plan is not really going to hurt the super rich because it's peanuts for them. People, the capital gains tax rate going up on them, it's going to hurt them. And so I'm talking about the small business owner, those who hope to achieve the American dream tomorrow. And that's where I think that's a major failing. That's giving in to a more progressive left than what many of us had thought he would do, because he campaigned as a moderate. So there's a real fear about that continuing and that trend. And so when you want to talk about the social, you can't help but think about the fiscal. But we are in this moment where it takes courage to set out and say, no, this is what I really believe in. And I have been a little bit let down by the Biden administration's lack of proper coalition building that I felt that they were going to be really committed to doing back when he was a candidate. So again, willing to give them time here, but there is a fair amount of disappointment, and people should know that. People should know that it is out there.
Hey everyone, I want to interrupt just for a brief moment and thank our sponsor, Escalante Yurts. You know, I've talked over the spring and summer months quite a bit about the wonderful outdoor opportunities in and around Escalante. But the weather is now cooling off, and the time to take advantage of the outdoors is waning if you want warmth. So jump online and make your reservation. But what I really want to talk about today is that the yurts are open year-round, even on all the major holidays. They have people come to the yurts and spend Thanksgiving, Hanukkah, Christmas, and New Year's, Bring your family, your decorations, meals and fixings, presents, and everything else, and come spend your holiday at the yurts. What a great way to celebrate a holiday that will be a fun and exciting memory forever. EscalanteYurts.com. Well, that's very interesting because we've addressed, you know, I've addressed this in my blog, I've addressed this in this podcast, and I've called it, so we addressed this back in January, and then we readdressed it maybe a month and a half ago. And what we called it is the potential for courage within the Biden administration. We called it that back in January, and we called it that a month and a half ago. And back in January, when we talked about it, it was addressing the, it was at the time when he was putting together his cabinet, and he was showing a willingness to be very progressive in with women, minorities, and right. so forth. And we saw first after first after first in yeah. his appointments. But, and so then we took that, we took the next step and said, okay, is he going to take that next step and give significant appointments to conservatives or even moderate independents or whatever the case may be? And it did not happen.
It did not happen. And one of my greatest sort of moments of thinking, what, during the Biden campaign was the pick of Vice President Harris. I wish he just said, I'm picking a really great person. It was some messaging that has always kind of made me feel funny, is that why do you have to say woman? You know, why do you have to indicate that you're going to pick a woman? You know, this is about really looking at people for what they are as people, not the boxes they fit into.
So it made you feel like he was picking her because of she was a woman, not because she had brought a great resume, great experience, and so forth.
And exactly. And she has a really fantastic resume, whether you agree with
whether you like it and agree with it.
Yeah, whether you like the policy stances or not. I mean, she's really accomplished a fantastic amount. I mean, she's the only vice president we've had in America that comes in with as much legal experience as she comes in with. That is remarkable. So in that whole tease of, oh, it's going to be a woman, and then it coming down to obviously a woman that comes from a biracial background, has overcome adversity in her life and has accomplished so much. It almost diluted it. It was the kind of thing.
Downplayed it, yeah.
It reminded me of how I remember coming up on Capitol Hill and being referred to as an Indian American. I've never lived in India for a day. I've visited five times maybe in my life, you know, probably a little bit more now, but that's, it's India's another country to me. It's where my family may come from ancestrally, but I'm just American. I was born in the Southern West Virginia coal fields. My dad lived his life, his dad and his dad lived in Uganda. My dad called himself Ugandan. He only lived in India temporarily for school for some 3 years, 3-4 years. And so we never identified as Indian except for on my mom's side, who was born and raised in India. And my dad met her when he was on vacation. It was kind of funny, really cute story. But again, it goes back to this hyphenation. Why do we have to hyphenate people? Why do we have to define people? Why do we have to tell them what boxes they're in? And it feels like Democrats have done that for so long. And I don't want to just say Democrats do that, that's bad. I just wish it wouldn't happen. I want to be seen as somebody who is a full and a complete just American. I don't need to be told I'm a, you know, oh, you're a millennial and you're a woman of color. Oh, and you're the daughter of immigrants. And you bring all these, I mean, you check all these boxes for us. Hi, what about me as just a person, you know?
Yeah, yeah. It's almost like you have to preface everything with all, look at what I'm doing. Look at who I've involved. And oh, and by the way, here's their resume. Here's what they've accomplished. Right.
And it should be the flip. I love that. Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to see more of that. Actually. Yeah.
So what do conservatives, moderates, okay, let me take a step back. So the parties have increasingly moved right and left, especially the Republican Party. The whole group has shifted to the left. Some of them were already there, shifted right. Some of them were already out there. Some of them shifted right with the party when Trump became involved and so forth. Some of us Some people have been left behind.
Yeah.
You know, you're in this, you're kind of in this political no man's land. It's that homeless nature, that homeless feeling that you talked about. So what do people in that who find themselves there, what do they do right now? What is in store for the Republican Party, for moderate conservatives? I had Greg Jenkins of the Franklin Project on here a day or two ago, and you know, and he talked about this and that, you know, so what do we do? What do we do in that area when we're homeless? What happens? What's going to happen to the political parties?
Well, that's a really loaded question.
Is that an unfair question?
It's not an unfair one. It's actually quite good, but it's so loaded because it's multi-layered and it's complicated. And I think that's what does dissuade a great number of people from feeling like this government is theirs, that this country belongs to them. And so if you ask me, I think we see a lot of people feeling really disenfranchised, and the apathy that's out there is so great because people have just felt unheard. They felt unrepresented. And I just kind of got into it on a text thread with some friends the other night, or actually just last night. My gosh, my days are running together. But I said, you know, look, as people who lean right, I'd love to read that exchange to you verbatim, because this is so important to me, that we have honest conversations, that we have awkward conversations, that we choose to engage in those with our friends and with strangers, because I think there's a lot of people out there who think they have the answers, but then they've just not been presented with the other side. And so if I can just distill it down to this, you know, it's easy for those of us who lean right to scream that we don't want the feds all up in our elections. But the bill in the Senate that didn't even make it to debate, for example, yesterday. I mean, when we're talking about voting rights, we're talking about something so sacred here. We're talking about protecting a sacred right for Americans. And what was in that bill, again, people who lean right will say it was unreasonable. I don't think it was. It established some minimums, and it was all basic stuff, given that foreign adversaries have been proven to meddle in our elections and to want to meddle in our future elections. So I would encourage people, whether you're a Democrat or Republican or whatever you feel you are, go try to find Senator Amy Klobuchar's floor speech from yesterday, October 20th. It was actually quite reasonable, and I've had my moments with Senator Klobuchar. I'm not like the biggest fan, but I'm also not a fan, if that makes sense. I think she's actually reasonable at times, and very much so. And she said, look, we're willing to consider amendments here. We are willing to negotiate. Let's just get to debate. And the Republicans didn't budge an inch on that. And that's where I say shame on them, but also shame on Chuck Schumer and company for not forcing the hands of the Republicans, because they know who the Republicans are at this point. They have not, Democrats in the Senate have not engaged in the hand-to-hand combat that's necessary to move the ball forward and protect the vote. This is so sacred. When you're talking about making it harder to vote in certain parts of the country, we're talking about leaving out a complete set of Americans. There's empirical data to back this up. All people need to do is go looking at reputable sources. But then there becomes that broader conversation of what is a reputable source? Check a bunch of sources, form your own opinions. But what I want to say is I'm fed up with both sides for different reasons right now. But I'm not giving up. So my advice is don't give up on it. You know, this government is yours. I've had friends over the years tell me, oh, you're our political friend. I said, how could you say it? This is for all of us. This is not a sport. This is not like, oh, I like to watch soccer instead of football. This is important because there are decisions being made in Washington, D.C. and our state houses that impact mine and your daily life. Now, I have really young children. They're under the age of five and under. But maybe, you know, maybe that's what it takes people to care, to become a parent, realize, okay, I'm going to send my kid into the public sphere and trust some bureaucrats to set what they're going to learn, right? And so maybe I should take a greater sort of involvement and care a little bit more. It shouldn't take that. We need to encourage one another to have awkward conversations and to dig and get down to what we believe is the truth and then operate from there. So I think if we saw all that, we would see some of these good bills that are intended to just do the bare minimum to protect our vote. we would see that kind of stuff pass without any kind of issue and this huge partisan rancor that we've seen. And also beyond that, getting people to care is not something that happens overnight. So that's going to be incumbent upon each of us to do it in our own creative way. But I get it. In this moment, it feels like a system is broken. So let's figure out how to fix the system. And I'll stop there with one thing, my one biggest prescription to really help fix American elections across the board. And in Utah, it has been, from what I understand right now, my stat on this might be a little rusty and outdated, but it has been engaged by many a county clerk in Utah, and it's ranked choice voting. That's RCV. Ranked choice voting is a change to how we vote for those who represent us. And it's basically, it eliminates that whole winner takes all, because that's what we've got right now at multiple levels of government. And it just keeps people feeling like, what's the point of showing up at the ballot box? So look into ranked choice voting. That's my number one prescription for how we get back to really a healthy democracy.
Okay. So does that fall within the realm of the significant political reform that the RDI is promoting?
Well, right now I can't speak for RDI and ranked choice voting, but I am involved with a number of other efforts and outfits. One of those is Represent Women. That is a great org, and don't let the name throw you off. We want men and women to come to and get acquainted with the stats. Represent Women is an org I've been on the board of directors for now a few years, but we are really the one-stop shop. If you want to learn anything about how American women engage in political life and government in the U.S., you will learn some astounding facts there. We were born originally out of a wonderful org called Fair Vote. And Fair Vote is advocating for ranked choice voting and has been for a long time and has been working with people across the political spectrum to talk about how ranked choice voting is a systemic change that is very palatable. And it's not even, look, I get it. Some people aren't into quotas or all that. I'm not into that either. But we need to talk about the changes that do make it more possible for people to access their government and feel represented. And if, with data to show evidence of that.
Okay. Very good. Very good. I'm going to research that myself a little bit. I know I'm familiar with the term and so forth, but I'm not real knowledgeable on that. So I'm going to research that.
Well, I'm happy to send you some stuff. And
yeah,
any
please
of the listeners who want to find me on Twitter, I'm happy to share. But
please
do check us out. Yeah. Represent Women. You'll find some good resources there.
So I understand you need to get going here pretty quick. So I want to ask a couple of questions in conclusion here, Rina.
Okay.
We are the Political Courage Podcast. We tend to, we like to ask a few questions, historical and courageous in nature to our guests on here. And it's kind of fun and very enlightening and very educational. And so I'm going to ask you a couple. What do you consider to be the most courageous act performed in office by George W. Bush?
Oh, boy. I love these. Well, can I back up and just say, I'm a big fan of the American presidency. I sometimes pinch myself when I think that I myself have worked on two American presidential campaigns. I cannot believe that the same little girl who was, I was 6 or 7 years old. It's well documented with pictures, and I need to get those pictures from the home of my parents. But I carried around a book that said, "What do you know about the American presidents?" And it was a trivia.
Oh, really?
Book. Oh, I was obsessed with the American presidency from a young age. I don't know why.
You know what? I have been the same way my whole life, and I, Eddie Zipper, who we had on this podcast a while back, he's a university professor in political science. And when he got that job, he's like, oh my gosh, he was kind of overwhelmed, I guess. And he set the goal for himself to read a biography, at least one book about every United States president. And I'm like, wow, what a fantastic goal. So I've set the same goal for myself and I've got a little ways to go, but kind of fun. It's a fun goal, you know, but
yeah, let me share in that one with you. I should take that on.
Yeah. It's kind of fun. You know, I've read, you know, when I started it, I had already read most of the prominent ones, you know, read at least something, but so I'm kind of going into some of the more obscure presidents now, but it's kind of fun.
No, that's great.
So anyway.
Yeah. Love the American presidency. Have studied it extensively at West Virginia University, my alma mater, when I was in the political science department there. As a minor student, I one of my professors and the head of the department that year was one of the greatest experts on the American presidency. Robert DiClerico is his name. Mm-hmm. And just a really, really great expert on it. And I think maybe that also furthered my interest as well. But to your answer your question and get right into it, I'll say this. You know, at first thought, it was the act of continuing to read the children's book to the children when George W. Bush learned that the towers had been hit, the first tower. And I think in continuing that, there's been a lot of debate. There's so many great documentaries out, you know, on Netflix, wherever you get your documentaries. You can really, you know, we are 20 years past that event. And it's heavy to think, wow, two decades. But I think that simple act of continuing was courageous, you know, to show sort of steadfast. And maybe, yeah, his face changed, but the demeanor to some extent, but to continue and to not rush into sort of maybe the alert mode that one would have thought at the time that somebody would undertake, given the severity of what had happened. I think that was big. And then, and sort of what followed was his big bullhorn speech that was three days after 9/11. So that was courageous as well. His address to a joint session of Congress, that was, I think, on September 20th, I believe. So all of that to me was very courageous. It's standing up and saying America won't stand down when we've been attacked. We will continue. And it's hard for people to understand the moment, but I think that was a really courageous act. And the second bit, I have kind of a twofer for that one. And sorry, listener, I know I'm a little bit verbose on this bit, but I just love this stuff. And I know it's up for debate. This is one that hits hard for a lot of people because we're talking about the death of someone. And I'm very much somebody that's sensitive to that. You know, life is life. But we're talking about the former Iraqi leader, Saddam Hussein, capturing Saddam Hussein in 2003. I think... wow, that pulling him out of a rat hole. I mean, it was just the capture was just so big, and I think that was courageous. That was a courageous act to undertake as a U.S. president. So I want to say that's my second one. That's definitely one that many people may not agree with on me, but yeah, big, okay. big and true for me.
All right, let's cross the aisle, Rina. What do you consider to be the most courageous act in office of Bill Clinton?
So I'm currently watching The American Crime Story on FX, and that is about Bill Clinton, and anybody that's been following sees that Monica Lewinsky is out in the public light, sort of talking about that time and watching American Crime Story and watching these episodes. Wow, I was pretty young at the time, so it definitely has not changed my opinion about Bill Clinton at all. It's just reaffirmed some things. I was not a big fan of his ever, but there are some things that we've got to be very, you know, we've got to recognize. There was, you know, the signature accomplishment of Clinton's governorship. I think I was not a fan of his presidency, but I liked Clinton before he came to the Oval, and I think one of his most signature accomplishments in the governorship was educational reform. What he did for the kids of Arkansas was so big. They raised the sales tax to pay for increased spending on education. It was needed at the time. Arkansas has been dead last at times, like my home state of West Virginia. But I think what Bill Clinton did by expanding even vocational training programs for different types of students, I mean, that was so great for Arkansas. And I wanted to nod to that because I think his time in the Oval was so complicated. And there are even polls that show that he enjoyed greater approval ratings after he was impeached. there's a lot that can be said there. You know, when he mobilized NATO to carry out airstrikes against the Bosnian Serb forces in Bosnia-Herzegovina, that was pretty big because what it did was force those combatants to come to the negotiating table. That was in the year 1995. And so that was 26 years ago. But that was a big, big accomplishment of Clinton's. Beyond that, I have trouble. I don't think there was much else he did that actually took any amount of courage. I think it was a man whose ego grew and grew beyond containment. So if you ask me in 95 what he did in Bosnia-Herzegovina, probably most courageous act it could take, because he really had an opportunity to change that region. And what essentially everything that happened in that region did was lead to, it all led to the independence of Kosovo. And that was, I think, so big. So that's courage to undertake that as a U.S. president in a region so far away. And I think as Americans, we don't know that as much. But I have trouble with Clinton. I can't say much beyond that. And I'm a foreign policy guy. So like, you know, I'll give him that one nod and that's it.
Don't apologize. You know, we don't agree with everybody. We don't. Hey, yeah. that's the nature of it, you know. Okay, one last question. Who, you know, you've qualified yourself as a fan of the United States presidency. Who's your favorite and why?
Oh my word, I love this question so much, because it's always going to be Abraham Lincoln.
Okay.
Always. They're hands down the 16th president. They just don't teach enough about him in school. When I was growing up, they all they tell you is Honest Abe. This guy, I mean, would we even be what we are today as a country? The good that we have in this country, would this country, all its goodness, exist today without Abe Lincoln? No, it would not, simply put. So I look back in history, in the arc of history for this country, we are still a young country, but I see Abe Lincoln as having been one of the most formative figures, a man who was probably a giant of his time. Not just in physical stature, as we know, but the incredible impact that he left on our country, no doubt speaks to that enduring legacy that I know fellow Americans do agree with me that he's had. And I mean, we're talking about a man who will forever be known as the savior of the Union and the emancipator of enslaved people. That is a black mark on this country's history forever. It is a tough one. We have so much trouble reckoning with to this day.
160 years later, we still do. Yeah.
Yes. But Lincoln, for what he was, and there are people who say, he had a complicated past too. I mean, what human doesn't? But I think the 16th president is just, to me, the most admirable, somebody that I'm so grateful existed.
Okay. Now I'm going to ask you this. As our last parting thought, you know, you had the shout out to voter integrity and so forth. As we conclude, do you have any last shout out for our listeners? Anything that you, any motivations, any thoughts, anything that you would like to throw out there, your shameless plug or anything that you would like to throw out?
You know, I'd like to say, you know, hey, listeners, let's take a little grace with everybody today, especially those of us who work in politics and sometimes appear on air. Let's figure out how to meet people where they are. To me, that's been so important mentally. We've got to put ourselves in other people's shoes. Let's be not quick to respond, but let's take some of the great, you know, values, whether they come from your house of worship or they come from just your family. You know, and how you've been brought up. Let's take some of the best of what we as people can stand for in the year 2021 and spread that, because it's been such a hard year. And those of us working in the political field have had a tough time, no doubt, over the years. But there are people that have had it so much tougher than me in other fields. And so I think we need to take grace with one another and sort of understand each other a little bit more and not be quick to respond, not be quick to put labels on people. So that's kind of what I just want to spread, that message of hope and stability, is that we can make this country just as good as we want to make it if we continually try. And there's no place like America to me. So I hope my fellow American listeners, and maybe there's somebody abroad listening as well, will take that and sort of spread that in their community. Because as they say in the political field, all politics is local. So locally, we need to build stronger communities, and we can do that by doing our part as well. So that's, you know, nothing else for me to evangelize about other than
thank you. That's fantastic. You know, and you mentioned something there. You know, you said your fellow Americans and wherever else. I watch my website and I watch where the listeners come from and everything. It's just a goofy thing that I like to do. Yeah. And we have quite a number of people from Canada, of course. We have people in Australia and Great Britain and Scandinavia are quite big.
Yeah.
And you know, and we focus on the United States. We focus on political leadership and the political spectrum and the political landscape and so forth. And it's all right here in the United States. But I think it shows the influence for good and bad that the United States has throughout the world. And so your message of positivity and empathy is powerful. Thank you.
Oh, thank you okay. for letting me share that.
No, we thank you greatly, Rina Shah, for taking the time to be with us today. This has been wonderful. It's been enlightening. We hope to have you back again, Rina, and have some additional conversations. This has been the Political Courage Podcast. Please visit us online, douglas-perkins.com/political-courage. Thank you and have a courageous day.